5 says the Lord has done great things.
Yes, he has.
I don't know about you, but he has done great.
Hallelujah.
For me. Marvelous things. Things beyond my expectation. He has done great things. Now, there is a word for us. Now, I know that I told him at 8 o'clock, you know, you first Sunday is celebration Sunday. We don't like nothing too tough. We just like to celebrate. But I just give you a full one. I didn't forget last week you told me that you wanted to grow.
Amen.
Before we leave, I'm going to tell you how we're going to do that. We're going into a series next week, and I'll tell you about it.
Amen.
But for today, there are many passages of scripture that we seem to pick some more often than others in order to preach sermons, and some we quote more than others because, you know, in our conversation, because they stand apart in their richness, you know, in eloquence and blessing. So we like to use them, we like to quote them, and our text for today is, you know, contains one of those most quoted and loved truths pertaining to the attribute of Jesus, to pertain to one of the attributes of Jesus. And I just want to share that with you quickly today as we celebrate on this first Sunday, as we move into our communion. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. There's one verse. I figured one verse all we can take today. Hebrews 13, verse 8. Told you it was one of the most quoted ones. And it says, Jesus Christ is the same when?
Yesterday.
How?
Today.
And?
Forever.
And forever.
Amen.
And forever. And it's what I already heard somebody say, that it's unchanged. That's what we want to talk about. I want to talk about the changeless Christ. The changeless Christ. Beloved, Hebrews 13 and 8 may be the reason for verse 7 or the grounds for verse 9. Or it may be a transitional statement connecting verse 7 and verse 9. But ultimately, this verse stands alone. It stands by itself. It stands above the surrounding exaltations. It is not about remembering spiritual leaders, nor is it about resisting false teachers. This verse makes an important statement about Christ himself. You see, we face a changing culture by faith in a changeless Christ. Anybody get that? We face this changing culture in which we live in by having faith in a changeless Christ. Now somebody says that's kind of messed up, because if we're living in a changing society, don't we need a Christ that changes along with it? Well, I beg to differ, beloved, because we are a people that change along with the culture. So we need a Christ, we need a Savior that does not change. Now I'm not saying, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that Christ is not aware of the changes. I'm not even saying that we don't have to, you know, maybe use some different language, you know, as we articulate Christ and the gospel, but he's still changeless. He has not changed, no matter the circumstances, no matter when it is, no matter how bad situations may be, no matter where we find ourselves, no matter what other people do, we can always count on Jesus. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Because somebody recognize and remember some of the times, and you may be in one right now, where Jesus was the only one you could count on. See, because Jesus would be there when everybody else would turn their back on you, walk away from you. They, you know, they even declare that they don't even know you. Jesus is still dependable. The writer of Hebrews has placed Jesus Christ center stage, turned on the spotlight, and admonishes us to consider him, consider Jesus as being better than the prophets, better than the angels, better than Moses, better than the Old Testament feasts and sacrifice. Now, here near the closing of his letter, he says that Jesus Christ is the same. Yesterday, today, and forever. The name Jesus Christ is empathetic. This whole name is only used 3 times in the book of Hebrews. This whole name. Hebrews 10:10 is about Christ as Savior. 13:21 is about Christ as our strength. Amen. And here in our text, Hebrews 13:8 is about Christ as our sustainer. He is our great high priest, ministering in the holy of holies in the tabernacle, not made with hands. He is the same, the text says, yesterday, today, and forever. He is the captain of our salvation and the author and finisher of our faith. He is the same, yesterday, today, and forever. You do realize people change. People change often. Some folks, you don't know where they're going to be or who they're going to be from 1 week to the next. People change. Our circumstances change. Pastors and other church leaders move away and, you know, pass away, go home to be with the Lord. Family members die suddenly. Severe weather, suddenly destroy homes and communities. The businesses we have, have been in for years fail. It says things, everything changed. We're in a changing society. As we grow older, we are often dismayed when we realize that things we used to do with ease, and now we struggle to do them, if we can do them at all. Why? Because things change. But Jesus Christ is changeless. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And beloved, that's what he was saying. What he said then and what he's saying now is that if he said it then, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. If he's changeless, that means what? That he won't leave you. That he won't forsake you. Huh? So let's look closely at this pearl of scripture. First, let's look at the name that claims immutability, Jesus Christ. First of all, we need to know that this is not a first and last name. Huh?
Amen.
Anybody agree with me?
Amen.
This is not a first and last name. As many, you know, as many suppose, when we say it, it's kind of like, you know, we're calling them, oh, you know, Jesus Christ. And then when we get in trouble, it's Jesus Christ. But it's not a first and last name, like my name, you know, Joseph Gessner. That's a first and last name. But Jesus Christ is not a first and last name. Jesus is the Greek translation of the Hebrew name Joshua. It means that Yahweh is salvation. In Acts, Peter declared in Acts 4:12, he says, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Jesus is heaven's wonder. Jesus is hell's worry. Jesus is humanity's way out of sin, guilt, shame, death, and even from hell itself. I know I've used a bad word twice. I don't apologize for it. Amen. Because I know, you know, hell is a bad word to us. We don't like to hear that word. But I'd rather hear than to end up visiting. First Timothy 2:5-6 says, for there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all. In other words, then Christ, or Christos, is also Greek, meaning anointed one. Jesus was anointed by the Father to the, you know, to the specific office of Redeemer. Luke quotes Peter as saying to Cornelius and to his family, it says in Acts 10:38, it says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And then David refers to the Lord's anointed in Psalms 2:1. It says, the kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord, the Father, and against his anointed, who is Jesus. So then, beloved, I said all that to say then that it would be more accurate when we're referring to the Lord as, you know, as Jesus, instead of Jesus Christ, it ought to be Jesus the Christ. Jesus the Christ. Jesus, the anointed one. Jesus, the known to his humanity. Christ is his deity. And when we use them all in the same phrase, we are both recognizing his humanity and his deity. Jesus says that he is our salvation. And Christ confirms that he was anointed and sent from God the Father for that very purpose. Watch this. Then by the statements of our text, the author goes on to cover the entire scope of eternity in the great word of encouragement. Jesus the Christ, he says, is the same yesterday. This phrase followed a little strange on our ear. How can someone not be the same yesterday? That is, if yesterday is gone, then they can't go back and change the way it was. But it does not make perfect sense. When we refer to the eternal, the uncreated Son of God, beloveds, you do understand that Christ did not become something more than he had been when he took on flesh, nor did he become less than he had already been. Watch this. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was what? The Word. And the Word was with who? God. And the Word was who? God. We know this is Christ. We know that the Word is Christ, and we determine that from the scriptures that follows that verse. But then Paul says in Philippians 2:6-7, he says, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking on the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. Don't get stuck on the casual surface reading of these verses and focus on the words equality, and empty. Remember, Jesus did not become less than what he was by becoming in the flesh. In other words, when Jesus came in the flesh, he didn't become less than he was in glory. He didn't become less by coming in the flesh and taking on the flesh. Even in the flesh, he was still everything that he was from the beginning. In fact, Paul says that in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And what does it mean? I know we're supposed to start teaching next week and we just celebrate him today. But what does it mean about the fullness of the Godhead bodily? What it's saying is that Jesus Christ is everything that God is in human flesh. Everything that God is, the fullness of the Godhead, the fullness of God in bodily flesh is what it means. To the Colossians, Paul also said in Colossians 1:6-16-17, it says, for by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him, and he is before all things, and in him all things consists. Beloved, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday. He is the eternal Word of God. And he is still the eternal Word of God. For from eternity past, he has been the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature. In other words, he is God. In other words, we're talking about the same yesterday. It's not talking about the same as he was the day before today. Yesterday points all the way back to the time when he was in glory with the Father. Yesterday points all the way back to the time when God stood out on nothing and declared for there to be something. Yesterday declares all that he was with God in his presence before time began. And it's saying that what the text is saying, that he is the same today that he was yesterday. Even before time began, he's still the same. Huh? Watch this. Beloveds, he knew every sin we would ever commit. He knew every foolish thought we would think. Every ungodly word we would speak. Before we ever spoke them. Huh? Before even speaking light into existence. He knew all of this. But yet, knowing all of this, he determined to temporarily lay aside the independence exercise of his own divine attribute and take on the form of a servant, becoming obedient to the point of death. And the text said, the Hebrew text said, even the death on the cross. We can rejoice that when we were nothing but a plan in the mind of God, his love toward us was the same that it is right now. Yeah. Right, think about it. When we were nothing but a thought in the mind of God, that his love was still the same for us. Huh? Somebody like me, we need to think about it. That even before we were a thought in our mama and daddy's mind, even before we were a seed in our mother's womb, God still thought about us, still had a plan for us, still loved us. When we were just a thought in his mind. And guess what? That same love that he had for us then, he still have it for us today. And what I like about that is, you know, even my own stuff, even my own ugliness, even my own mess, my own sin has not changed the way he feels about me. I haven't done anything to mess up how he feels. Now don't get me wrong, I'm not saying I haven't messed up. I just haven't messed up bad enough for him to change how he felt about me when I was just a thought in his plan. And then secondly, the text says, Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today. We understand that. The yesterday, we can't really understand what is meant by saying that he is the same today unless we are clear on what today means to God. God is the God of the ever-present, eternal today. He exists in all of eternity at once, with no reference to time. For him, all time, watch this. For God, all time is today. Anybody get that? Now remember, he existed in a time that was no time. So today, all time is today. Huh? In the eyes of God, we have to understand that God is the God of ever presence. Beloveds, as long as we have breath in our body and blood runs warm in our veins, it is today. It's today. It's today. And just a little side note in there, you notice the text. You notice the text, what the text says. The text says the same yesterday, today, and forever. It didn't say tomorrow. It didn't say the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. It said forever. Just thought I'd throw that in there with you. Now, beloveds, you understand that when the writer penned the words, Jesus the Christ is the same yesterday and today, some 2,000 years or more ago, for him, it was today. It was today then. It is today for us now. The writer of Hebrews was thinking of one who stood in a small boat and commanded the storm and the wave to cease. He was thinking of one who touched and cleansed even the leper. Jesus the Christ, the same yesterday and today. He is not a departed hero to be emulated, or a loved one whose memory is to cherish. He is the Lord of today. The Lord of today. And see, the good part about it is he is the Lord of today. When we get to tomorrow, as we say, when we get to Monday, he's still the Lord of today. Even if it's Friday, he's still Lord of today. So he says the same. Not only is he the same as he was from before the world was formed in time and eternity, he's the same every day, because every day is the day for him. That means every time we open up our eyes and step into a brand new day, we can realize that Christ is the same today. But then, the text don't stop. The text don't stop. There's a little simple text. It says, thirdly, it says that Jesus and the Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Beloved, once we understand that Jesus the Christ is the same yesterday, today, and then now, can we finally realize and live in believing faith that he is the same forever? This has been declared throughout Scripture. Watch this scripture proof of that. Malachi 3:6 says, "For I am the Lord, I do not change. Therefore, you are not consumed, O sons of Jacob." Psalms 33:11 says, "The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations." James 1:7 says, "Every good and perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning." Psalms 102:27 says, "But you are the same, your years will have no end." And then Jesus said of himself in Revelation 1:8, he said, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty." He declares himself to be eternal. Beloved, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But before the worlds were hung in space, before God made the garden and instructed Adam not to eat of the tree, before the law was given on Sinai, before the sacrifices and the feast days, Jesus the Christ was the same as he was in the beginning. And he went when he said to in John 11:25, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, shall live. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is a changeless Christ. His provisions don't change. His promises don't change. His healing touch don't change. His holy character don't change. His righteousness stands. Standards don't change. His eternal purpose don't change. His living word will not change. His saving power will not change. His steadfast love will not change. His sovereign authority will not change. He is an unchanging God. I think I just need to say this as the head of my seat. See, beloved, because God is the same yesterday, today, forever, that he is changeless. God is not going to change his program to fit ours. Huh? God is not going to change. I told you from the beginning, we live in a society that's changing. There's pastors and preachers and churches that's going around saying now there are certain words in the Bible we can't say because they are not sensitive. And we're trying to massage the language to fit change in society. But we need to understand that God's principles are not going to change. God's principles is not going to change. We can change the law to make anything be right according to the law. But God is not going to change. His principles are not going to change. His standards are not going to change. I don't care whether we like them or not. They're still not going to change. Every person on this earth, every person on this planet could decide they don't like one of God's principles. We just think it's wrong. We're going to strike it out of the Bible. You can tear the Bible up, you can burn that page, and it's still not going to change God's principles. And see, beloveds, really what I'm trying to say is that this change is Christ in this changing world. I won't say it don't matter because it does matter what the world does. But the world can change anything they want. It's not going to change God's mind. And I'm not trying to step on nobody. But it's kind of still hot news. Every state, every country on this planet can change their law and say that same-sex marriage is okay. It's not going to change God's principle. Every person, every believer on this planet can say that it's all right for two men to be sexually engaged, two women to be sexually engaged, nobody's going to get in trouble. But it's still not going to change God's mind. I'm just trying to clear the record. Every person, every church on this planet can declare that it's all right for two consenting adults that's not married to be sexually engaged. And nobody's going to get in trouble. But it's still not going to change God's principle that he says that it's fornication and that it's a sin against his principle. Every person in this planet, every church can hang out a banner, say it's all right for husband and wives to have affairs and extra sexual activity, you know, in their life, and it's all right, and nobody's gonna get in trouble, but it's still not gonna change the principle of God, where God says that is adultery and that is still a sin. See, we have to really understand this change in this Christ, because we love the part where he's changing. He's not gonna stop loving us. No matter who we are, that he's gonna love us through thick and thin. And he's gonna keep on loving us when we get old, we get crippled, we get blind, we get sick. He's gonna keep on loving us and pouring out his grace and mercy on us. We just love that. But we also have to take into consideration that this changeless Christ is not going to change his man about sin and the way that we live. We have to take the whole picture. We have to take the whole thing in scope when we talk about the changeless. These have been the principles, the values of God, even before time began. They were still God's principles. They are God's principles today, right now. And they will be God's principles even after he has come back for the church. They will still be his principles, because if his principles had a time frame, then he wouldn't be a changeless Christ. So all the Lord is trying to say to us today, yes, he is changeless. And we need to be aware of that. I think that if we were truly aware of it, some of us might be a little scared. Some of us might be a little bit worried if we really understood the changeless of it. Because God is not going to change his mind. He's not going to change his mind. No matter what. If it violates his word, his principles, he's not going to change his mind, beloveds. I don't care who says right. I don't care if you won't get a ticket or you won't go to jail or you won't be cast aside. If it violates the word of God, he's not going to change his mind. Never said this last thing. Say this last thing, then we extend the privilege. Because today there's so much teaching and preaching that pretty much all we have to do is be good folk. Don't hurt nobody. Don't kill nobody. You know, give a hand out to the needy. Just be good all the way around. we can kind of work and serve and live good our way on to glory. But I got news for you. The word of God, Jesus said that no one comes to the Father except through him. In other words, no one gets to the Father, gets to glory, gets to heaven, except there's a personal relationship in the Lord Jesus Christ. Guess what? God is not going to change his mind. Now you can think he's going to change his mind and just, all I got to do is just be a good person. Just treat everybody else the way that I want them to treat me. That's good, but that's secondary to a faith in a risen Savior. There's a flaw with that. We believe in our heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and repent of our sins and ask him to come in our hearts and save us. And then we start doing good to folks and helping folks and serving folks and loving folks there and being caring toward folks. But it follows that personal relationship. Or his changelessness kicks in. See, he's not going to change just to suit you. He's not going to change just to suit me. Oh well, you know, brother. Yesterday, I know you were a good dude. You would get somebody your last pair of shoes, and you know you'd go help them, and you know you'd do everything for them. You're the man. So I tell you what, you don't have to believe in Jesus. Just come on to glory. He's not going to change his program for me. He's not going to change it for you. This change in his Christ is not going to change toward us and say it's all right that now that we have believed and accepted him into our heart, that we can live any kind of way we want, act any kind of way we want, talk any kind of way we want, treat folks any kind of way we want. He's not going to say that it's all right to us. Because if it ever been wrong, it's still wrong. And gonna stay wrong. But because he is changeless, in spite of who we are, how we are, he still loves us. He still loves us. But I want you to know something. He still loves us so much. But he would not violate his holiness for us. No matter how much he loves us, he will not violate his holiness for us. He loves us, every one of us, in spite of who we are, in spite of what we do. But he won't violate his holiness just to save us. We must have a personal relationship with him.
Amen. All right. Amen.
This changeless Christ is still offering men, women, boys, and girls the opportunity to be saved by his principles, not by ours, not by the world. So if you're here today, and you have never made a confession of faith, you have never confessed that I believe in my heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. I believe that he died on Calvary's cross. I believe that the Father raised him up on the third day. I believe that he is seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for me right now. And if I asked him to forgive me of my sin and come into my heart, he's faithful to do it right now. I don't have to clean up. I don't have to make up. I don't have to do anything except for believe in my heart. And as I believe in my heart, I will confess the same with my mouth. And I shall be saved. Is there one here? Is there one here today that need to yield your life, give your life to the Lord and ask him to come into your life and save you? You might be a good person. You might be one of the best persons in here. But if you have not done that, the changeless Christ will still not change his mind about you. Is there one here? Then if you're here, you saved, you know you're saved. You've been part of a church. You've been baptized. You've been serving in a ministry. But now you live in this community of Moreno Valley Parish, Riverside area, San Jacinto. And you've been looking for a church ministry. And the Lord has brought you here and said, I want to use you, your gifts, your talents, right here through this ministry. If you're here, and that's you, and you feel the presence of the Lord tugging on your life right now, I extend this opportunity for you to come and say, yes, Lord, I hear your voice. Yes, Lord. God bless you. God bless you. Someone else. Someone else. Someone else. If the Lord is speaking to you, you've been looking for a church ministry. You've been here, there, to, fro, and God has brought you here today. And you hear his voice clearly speaking to you. He'll bless you right now for being obedient. Someone else, we don't want to leave you. Are you absolutely sure? Listen, as the deacon asks, give us her name and